I have no idea what Ted was thinking when he asked me to do this, but I am beyond fired up to be here today. And the reason is really simple. I've actually had a chance to read this book. And seriously, in many ways,
you're the one.
It is life. It has really, really helped me. I can't wait for you all to get a chance, okay, to read it, because it's truly exceptional. I think you know our guest tonight. He's really amazing. I mean, Robert Reich is an American political economist, obviously. He's a professor, he's an author, he's a political commentator. The man has served Republicans and Democrats, both Gerald Ford and Jimmy Carter. He was Secretary of Labor under Bill Clinton, right? But now he's a professor, right? He's the Chancellor's Professor of Public Policy at the Goldman School of Public Policy at the University of California, Berkeley, my part of the world. Yeah, yeah.
Go Bears.
So, go Bears, right? So he's written 14 books, the most recent of which is the one we're here to talk about tonight, Saving Capitalism. And, you know, because the book is brand new, I suspect most of you haven't had a chance to read it yet, right? Right? Okay, so let's start by giving him a chance to tell us the core points of the book. And then we're going to have a conversation about not only what's in it, but what we all can do to make the most of our future. Robert, please tell us about
the book. Thank you, Roger. And it's great to be here. Thank you all for coming tonight. This is a lovely, lovely... And this is a great kind of setting and great auditorium. It doesn't feel too large, and it feels kind of intimate. So this book, let me tell you
about the book. It feels sold out, which is really exciting.
Well, let me...
I play rock and roll, so I'm really into box office, you know?
I want to tell you about the book. I don't want to tell you so much that I give away the plot.
Everybody dies in the end.
No, that's not true. We flourish, all of us, in the end. Essentially, I wrote it because I have been examining, worrying about, teaching about, even made a movie about inequality and widening inequality of income and wealth and political power. But I finally decided that I had to write about power specifically, about the corrosive effects of widening inequality on our democracy, but in a very particular way. And maybe, Roger, it would be useful if I talked about the actual triggering event. I spend too much of my time debating conservative economists in various forums, and no matter what the topic is, it really could be anything. It could be global warming, climate change, it could be extraterrestrials. I mean, it doesn't matter, because within about 4 minutes, the topic somehow is reduced to the question of who do you trust less, government or the market? And then we get into a debate that I've been having with conservatives for at least 40 years, and that is government versus market. And it always struck me it was kind of an absurd debate. In fact, I was suspicious of it. It seemed to me that the debate was a deflection, a distraction from a more important debate that somehow people didn't want us to have. Not in a conspiratorial or a paranoid way, but simply it was a substitute for thought. Because the market cannot exist without government. Government sets the rules of the market. Government creates and enforces the market. Without the market, without government, the market would be nothing. It would be, it would be in the state of nature. There is no market. There's just survival of the biggest and strongest. It's like the playground when I was 5 years old. And that is not what a civilization provides for. I mean, as a civilization, you have rules. A market has rules. Those rules come from judges. They come from administrative agencies. They come from legislators. And they're constantly revised. And this is another very important point. The market rules are constantly, at the detailed level, they're constantly being changed. You know, what do we mean by intellectual property? What qualifies? The genome Can the genome be patented? How long can a patent last? If you're a pharmaceutical company, can you buy out a generic company and get longer terms to your patent? All kinds of questions that go to the very heart of the building blocks of capitalism have got to be decided by people, and they are elected or they're appointed. Now, once you accept that premise, then a lot of the rest of the book and the argument falls into place. Because the question is not the size of government, the question is not government versus market, the question is, this system, this political economic system, is it working for the vast majority, or is it working for a small minority at the top? And if it's working for a small minority at the top, is there not a danger that you get into a kind of self-fulfilling, maybe a vicious cycle, in which those at the top, because they are, in effect, having a disproportionate influence on the rules of the market, are getting more and more of the gains from the market? You follow? And if they're getting more and more of the gains from the market, then they have more and more power to influence the rules of the market. So you kind of see the compounding of this, and at a detailed level, it's quite extraordinary. We don't talk about this. We don't talk about it at that level of detail. We don't connect the dots the way they should be connected. The other thing that is revealed is that the mythology that we're paid what we're worth becomes clearly a mythology, because behind that notion that we're paid what we're worth is really a moral claim that we are paid what we are somehow worth in a moral universe, or in terms of social benefits and social costs. But of course, if the market itself is not necessarily morally justifiable, then what we're paid is simply a tautology. That is, we're paid what we're worth in the market, but it has nothing to do with what we are actually worth in any socially meaningful or morally important way. And finally, the third mythology that I tackle in the book is that most of the public policy question, most important public policy question with regard to widening inequality, is how much you tax the people at the top and redistribute. It's not that that's an unimportant question, it is important, but that question also is a deflection from a far more interesting and far more important set of realities having to do with how much the bottom 60, 70, 80, 90% redistributes, I actually use the word predistributes upward to the top, because the market is organized in such a way that it actually gives rise to those predistributions, but they're hidden. Most of us don't know it. We don't pay attention to it. And yet, I think I show as convincingly as I can that those predistributions are way larger, magnitudes larger, than any redistribution anybody is talking about. So that's the frame of reference, and then we get into the central questions, and that is, what do you do about it? And I know what to do about it.
Now, yeah, we're going to tax you on the way out if you want to find the answer to that question. So I'm really curious. Was there a moment, when did you know that it was time to save capitalism? Or well, that capitalism even needed saving?
No, it's interesting, because I've been on this book tour now for a couple of weeks. And there are two kinds of responses to the book, to the title. I mean, not to the book, because people have not read it yet. You two read it, and you've read it. So there are three of you have read it. But the two kind of responses to the title are a group of people. Some people say, we're a little offended. That title sounds as if you're criticizing capitalism. It's a beautiful system. It doesn't need saving. And then there's another group of people, a lot of people who I hang around with, Berkeley and elsewhere, who say, why do you want to save capitalism? Well, so it's I found the title that antagonizes everybody.
Beautiful. But except the three of us.
But the most important, the most important aspect of the title, actually, you both know and you know, is the subtitle, for the many, not the few.
One of the things that I was struck by was the sense of deja vu that you bring out in the book relative to 100 years ago, the Gilded Age, and the fact that as a country, not only have we been here before, but we thought we had fixed this very problem.
Well, we never fix it. There have been four historical periods when we made headway, and then the problem inevitably rears itself up again, and you have to continue to work on it. I mean, we first began working on it in a serious way in the 1830s, in the Jacksonian period. The Jacksonians were not adverse to capitalism, but they were very much concerned about aristocracy. Mm. And they set out to change the rules of the game so that we would not have an aristocracy. Change the corporate form, change suffrage, expanded suffrage. They did quite a number of things, some of which were wise.
I think it's worth putting a pin in that for a sec. When they changed suffrage, they got rid of the land-owning requirement.
Yes.
Right? So they actually made the America, from a democratic perspective, that we think of today.
It's interesting we don't pay much attention to that Jacksonians, but we'll come back to them.
There are other reasons why we don't, I think.
Right? Yeah, well, especially, you know, Andrew Jackson was in many ways a terrible man and
That's
a terrible president, and what he did to Native Americans, you know, is close to genocide. But for the purposes of our discussion here, they were very much anti-aristocratic. They were populist, but they were authoritarian populists. Now, again, I want to put a pin in that, too. Come back to that. And then you had the progressives of 1901 to 1916. You know, the Gilded Age of the 1880s and 1890s was almost exactly what we have today. In fact, if we were having this discussion in 1900, we would probably have the same discussion we are having right now.
But you'd be wearing a tie.
Hugely wide inequality. I'd have a fedora of some sort. I'd be taller. but it would be, you know, we talk about widening inequality, we talk about squalor in our cities, we talk about massive corruption, how the robber barons had lackeys who would put sacks of money on the desks of pliant legislators. And we'd all be quite cynical about ever doing anything about this. It would just seem like everything was falling apart, the economy and our democracy. And then, of course, 1901 happened, but it didn't just happen. It was the culmination of a groundswell, just like in the 1830s, of discontent that reached a kind of tipping point. And, of course, Teddy Roosevelt was there. And then again in the 1930s, cleaning up from the avalanche of the Great Crash and the Depression. And then in the 1960s, you know, some of you in the audience, I included, had a little participated in the 1960s, and that was a period in which there was an upsurge. We didn't go as far as we should have and wanted to do, but certainly with regard to voting rights, civil rights, expanding the suffrage, expanding the circle of prosperity, fighting elderly poverty, Medicare, Medicaid, and eventually even the Environmental Protection Act of 1970. A lot of things happened in that period of time, and it was a period of populist and progressive upsurge because we were off track in some important ways. Well, we're just about to the fifth period of progressive populist upsurge, but it also could be, are you ready for this? It could be authoritarian populist upsurge.
So you better tell us about that.
I don't want to.
Okay, so you're going to have to come back next week. Same bat time, same bat channel.
No, I was reading just this morning that Carl Icahn, we were talking about this. I shouldn't even say this publicly, but I know him, we've debated, he and I were debating in the late 70s, you know, having it out on Ted Koppel. Nobody even remembers Ted Koppel anymore.
Nightline.
Remember Ted Koppel? Well, I remember, I just said, it was 1979, Carl Icahn was doing his corporate raids and he was taking over, I don't know whether it was RJ or Nabisco or TWA.
TWA was
TWA, and he was wrecking it. I mean, it was just, you know, turning these corporations from stakeholder capitalism into shareholder capitalism in a very mean-spirited way. And I was kind of charging him with Ted Koppel. I said, "You shouldn't do this. You know, you're causing people to lose jobs. You're creating a beast that is devouring communities. People are going to lose not only their jobs but their livelihoods, their communities." And he lost his temper. He screamed right into the television. You know, we were in different places, so he was looking. He said, "You don't know what you're talking about." And his eyes got so large, and I thought he would come. So today he started his own personal super PAC with $150 million of his own money today. And of course, the person he is supporting, Donald Trump. And just to make the story even more interesting, Donald Trump says that he was elected, if Donald Trump is elected, he's going to make Carl Icahn his Secretary of the Treasury.
It's a lucky thing that money can't buy success in politics in America, right?
Anyway, I thought I'd just cheer you all up with that.
So, So the problems you're describing are systemic, right? I mean, essentially, the basic notion here is that we have a group of people who have been very fortunate by means of birth or timing. You know, I don't know how many of you have read Malcolm Gladwell's book, Outliers, but it makes a really profound point to me about the fact that when you were born and where you were born has a large impact on what comes afterwards. If you were born in 1942 or 43, the probability of becoming a guitar hero was much higher than any other year. If you were born in 55 or 56, you had a chance to start a personal computer company. And if you didn't, you just missed the window, right?
And well, actually, the most important year to be born in was 1946.
Good, of course.
Well, I mean, Bill Clinton, mm-hmm. George W. Bush,
you,
me, Donald Trump,
you.
No, but I just said me.
No, I'm repeating. And, I'm trying to prioritize you a little
bit. I mean, almost anybody was anybody.
Yeah, my older brother
was born in 1946.
But this notion, to me, that one of the things that I note that is seems to be, you know, these are systemic problems, and they're compounded by a lack of self-awareness on the part of the people in charge, which is they truly believe that they deserve everything they've got.
I'm
as
sorry,
opposed to the
Ken Starr.
Oh,
1946.
There we go. It gets better, huh?
I rest my case.
Yeah.
I'm sorry,
but. You know, to me, this issue that these things are systemic. The rules favor a narrow minority that maybe is not aware enough to appreciate the good fortune that they've had to get there, and who, acting completely, you know, in alignment with incentives, are doing these things that make the world for everybody else, even if they are aware of it, just by acting naturally in their job. So if you're a rich person, you hire lawyers, you hire accountants, you hire investment bankers, and their job is to make you more rich. You hire lobbyists, their job is to make you more successful.
And that's why it's important not to demonize anybody. And I try, well, it's very important that in our normal discussions, we don't demonize the rich or the poor or immigrants or anyone else. This is a system, and it has to be viewed as a system. And the question is the system functioning or is it malfunctioning? And if it's not functioning, how do you begin the chicken and egg
thank
problem.
You. Yes, because I was going to give you all a pro tip. He doesn't think it's functioning, okay?
So I don't think it's functioning because, for one thing, for the last 30 years, the economy is almost twice as large as it was in 1980, but the typical American worker, the median wage, is almost where it was in 1980, adjusted for inflation. Almost all the economic gains have gone to the very top. This recovery, by the way, is the first recovery, so-called, in history,
right.
And we don't talk about this very much, in which the median household is actually poorer today than when the recovery started. And you have most people, again, the last couple of weeks I've been talking to a lot of people about these issues on this book tour, most people don't feel that they have had a recovery at all. And, Roger, when I go through airports very often, And I think it's because I'm fairly conspicuous. People come up to me who I don't know at all. It happened just 2 days ago. I was in the airport, and they come up to me and they say things as if we have been in a conversation. And 2 days ago, I was in Seattle. Somebody came up. I was just coming to the airport. They said, "Can you believe it?"
And how do you come back?
I said, "What?"
Last week in
St. Louis in the airport, somebody came up again. Don't have any idea who this person is, and they said, "What are we going to do?"
And you said, "I'm going to get a sandwich, and then I'm going to get on my plane."
I said, "I'm hungry. I think that I've never had as many." This is kind of my own free-floating focus group. But the polls also show a degree of anger, upset, anxiety, not only with one's own economic condition, but with the country as a whole. It just feels to people, and people don't make a sharp distinction between economics and politics, it just feels like the system is fundamentally off track.
So how do we break that cycle? How history says sometimes you break it with a war, sometimes you break it with a depression. Sometimes you break it with violence in the streets.
Well, you didn't. Are there any other alternatives? A war and a depression and violence in the streets, they're not good things.
That's and note so, to self, okay? But, another but
going,
pro tip.
But going back to the 1900, that is the 1899-1901 period, I think that's a more interesting and positive way of looking at it. As I mentioned before, there was a kind of a populist uprising, really from the grassroots. There were some elite members, some business types, some people who were very wealthy, who understood that it was dangerous for the society as a whole to have so wide a gap in income. There were even a few people who were writing at the time that if you had so much money going to the top, you wouldn't have enough aggregate demand to keep the economy going. They were just worried in just sheer
economic
terms.
And this was actually one of Henry Ford's positive contributions.
This was the only positive contribution that Henry... No, Henry Ford made a couple of positive, and he was also an anti-Semite, and he made some negative contributions, too.
He was a horrible human being.
But he did understand a few years after this that if you pay your workers more and you encourage other employers also to lift the prevailing wage, that it's good for the economy. More people have more money to buy things. But what I meant to say is that you had in 1900 an upsurge of a kind of populist nature. It came on the heels of the 1896 presidential election, William Jennings Bryan, Cross of Gold. So the country was primed for this. But it was a national effort to put ideology aside and get on with what we need to do. Now, other nations, having gone through periods of economic stress, have done other things. They have gone into fascism or to other forms of totalitarianism, communism. We tend not to. We tend to be very pragmatic. And I think we're going to see that again. In the book, I say that the key division in the future will not be Republican versus Democrat, or even necessarily liberal versus conservative. The key division we will see in the future, and I wrote this before Bernie Sanders and Trump, would be establishment versus anti-establishment. And that the anti-establishment forces were already beginning to grow. And that can be a very constructive, or as I suggested just a moment ago, it can be also very destabilizing and very dangerous, depending upon who gains control of that momentum.
So are you optimistic?
I am optimistic.
So tell us why, then.
Well, I've already suggested why, at least one reason I'm optimistic, because four times before, we have done the right thing. We've got capitalism, our system, back on track. Secondly, I'm optimistic because there is a remarkable degree of consensus around certain moral principles with regard to our economic system. For example, you should not be working full-time and be in poverty. Most people agree with this. And this is This is not just Democrats and liberals and progressives. This is actually most conservatives and most Republicans actually agree with that principle. No, I just came from. Well, we'll talk later. Another principle is we don't want a permanent aristocracy of inherited wealth in this country, and this is a deeply held principle. It goes all the way back to the founding fathers. And then a third principle is everyone should have an opportunity, an equal opportunity, to make the most of themselves. And that has been a principle that has been very essential to our views of education, of anti-discrimination, of a lot of other things we've done. Again, broadly based moral principles. But there is a huge gap between each of those principles and the reality that we are finding ourselves in. Now, the good news is that if you look at when we have had social change in this country, it's when the gap between the ideal and the reality becomes so great that the cognitive dissonance is so uncomfortable, people really have got to move, they've got to change.
You have a magic wand. What do you want us to do? What are the steps that the country is supposed to take to get from the place we are today back on the track?
Well, it has a lot to do with the concept of countervailing power that I develop in the book. And again, I don't want to give away too much of the plot. Will you,
guys, the book is fantastic. You really should read it no matter what he tells you now.
Did you hear that?
And I'm an actor, not a paid spokesman, okay?
And I'll be signing books, and I'll be personalizing them for you. You know, a study was made of my signing people's books, and once I put my name on the book, the value on eBay actually goes down. Yeah. So, countervailing power. My mentor, the person to whom I actually dedicate the book, a man named John Kenneth Galbraith, and he taught me a great deal. Ken Galbraith was 6'7". We made an odd couple. But one of the books he wrote in 1952 was a book called American Capitalism, The Concept of Countervailing Power. And the theme of his book was the reason that we seem to be expanding the circle of prosperity as rapidly as we were, and more people were finding themselves just part of this extraordinary growth. The world had never seen a middle class growing so exponentially. He thought the reason was that the real legacy of the New Deal was to create centers of countervailing power that countervailed the big corporations, the Wall Street banks, and the very rich politically. Ken Galbraith was more than an economist. He really was a political economist in the best sense of the word. And he saw that labor unions and small farmers in farm cooperatives and small retailers protected from big chain retailers and small local and regional banks protected from the big Wall Street banks and a number of other centers of countervailing power actually balanced society. They gave people an opportunity to have some of the gains from our economy, and also gave people a voice politically. That was an important insight, and I think what's happened over the last 30 years is that all of those centers of countervailing power, and there were many others that he talked about, have disappeared. And that's what has to be rebuilt. In other words, instead of attacking the wealthy, what we really do have to do is think systemically about what's wrong with our political economic system, and we've got to start rebuilding countervailing power. There are ways of doing it, and I think we are in the process of doing it, and I could get into that.
Well, I was, having read the book, I made a list of some of the centers of countervailing power, but they're all very small so far. You have one building around Elizabeth Warren. You have one building around Bernie Sanders. You have Black Lives Matter. You have Edward Snowden, a one-man countervailing power. You have GLAAD. You have the people who think cannabis should be legal. You have Richard Dawkins, right? There's a whole set of people who are essentially presenting themselves as a place to unite, none of which have built more than a relatively small power base, and certainly not enough to influence the outcome yet.
Yeah. Well, I think
are there others that I'm missing?
Yes, I think you're looking through the other end of the telescope about
at
individuals.
That's why I'm in this seat,
Roger,
not in that seat.
I admire your effort there, and I think that you're right. I'm sorry. I think you're right. But
redo for Friday.
No. But what I'm suggesting is it's less about individual people, and it's more about social movement. That is, as I go around the country, I am struck by the fact that, for example, in central Missouri, small farmers are organizing. They're organizing and they're linking up with farmers in Nebraska and elsewhere to take on the factory farms and the big agricultural sort of monopolies, including Monsanto, and they're gaining political traction. Now, and then the fight for 15 people, the people who are working for a $15 minimum wage, they tend to be relatively poor, they tend to be people of color, they are mostly inner cities, mostly women, but they are working very effectively. They are organizing themselves. I talk to them now. I've talked to 8 groups in different cities. Mm. They are linking up, and they are becoming a very important political movement. I suggested, by the way, just incidentally, to some of the people who are in the Fight for 15 movement that they link up with the small farmers because they have much in common. And I also have been meeting with small business people across the country, in red states, in Cincinnati, for example. They are very concerned because they feel that the big banks, they can't get loans, they feel that the big banks are conspiring in a way against them, and they are trying to resurrect the notion of state banks and local banks, and, you know, you can applaud. I mean, I think what I'm trying to get at is all of these elements of countervailing power are beginning to organize in very interesting ways. And I think that, again,
I'm
wearing
my... Can we do a show of hands? Were any of you aware of either of the organizations that he just described? Okay, so you guys, so I'm just ignorant, okay. Because
well,
I was not aware of either one of them.
Well, I could go on, but what I'm seeing around the country is a latticework of organizations that are... They're beginning to form, and some of them have been working for 10 years or more, but they're beginning to form against the powers, again, large corporations, Wall Street, and some very wealthy individuals that are otherwise taking over the political apparatus. And I think it's very encouraging. It is very much and very similar to what the United States experienced in the last decade of the 19th century.
Done that way, from that level, that doesn't sound like something that's going to be happening this election cycle or even the next couple, right?
It's hard to know how quickly, what the tipping points are. Politically, it's very difficult. I would have said, when I wrote the book, again, that was before Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump, and I hate to even use the two names in the same sentence. But I would not have predicted that Bernie Sanders would have been as successful. I mean, think of the numbers of people that are going to these rallies. We haven't seen. I mean, I don't remember, even in 1968, I started getting very involved in politics in 1968. I was involved with Eugene McCarthy and the...
Me too.
You were too.
Age 12, I worked full-time in the New York primary for 8 weeks, every single day.
Really? Well, I was older than you because I had to keep clean for Gene, which meant that shave and do a lot of other things.
No pot. No, my brothers worked there.
But and I had worked for Robert Kennedy, but there was nothing comparable to 20 or 30,000, 40,000 people in a stadium that have come out for Bernie Sanders. And it's not, what I want to emphasize with you is I don't think it's Bernie per se.
Right.
Had it been Elizabeth Warren, that would be the same groups out there for the same reason. I think that there is this energy that is coming to the surface.
And do you, how do we make sure that if the dreams the people are having around Bernie or Elizabeth Warren are not immediately fulfilled, how do we keep that energy moving in a constructive way?
Well, it's a good question. Well, it's actually two questions. One is, how do you keep the energy? And then how do you keep it moving constructively?
Okay.
And those are always two very, very central questions. Our tendency, regardless of where we are on the political spectrum, when we get involved in a political campaign, if our candidate wins, is to say, well, that's it, let's go home. And if our candidate loses, to kind of be angry and then go home.
Right.
And I think that what we've got to understand is that there is no stopping. That an election is just, even if our candidate wins, is just the beginning of the hard part. One of the saddest lessons I had in the Clinton administration, I was kind of excited. Bill Clinton, who I had known since he was 22 years old, was elected president, and he wanted me to come down and be in his cabinet. And I thought, wow, we can do all these wonderful things. And the second day I was Secretary of Labor, I think it was about the second day, Congress passed the Family and Medical Leave Act. And I was down there, and I had to implement it, and I thought, this is a cinch. There's nothing to this. We can do, this is just, you just decide what you want to do, and you do it.
Right. Just like the Bush administration.
Yes. but here's the thing. What I learned, and I had kind of known this before, is that you can have good people in Washington, but it doesn't matter unless you have good people outside Washington who are mobilized and organized and energized to put the pressure and keep the pressure on the good people in Washington to do the right thing. The same thing with policies. I mean, we could sit here. I could tell you what policies I think are important to get the big money out of politics and reversing Citizens United and providing public financing and having Medicare for all. And we could go through all of the things that we, and resurrecting Glass-Steagall and all the things. And, you could maybe, if you agreed with me, you could applaud or not. But it's all hot air, unless you're talking about power. Unless you're talking about how to get the power to make this happen. And that's really what the book is about.
And so the piece of this that I look at is, you were working on this, doing all this work. You gather an enormous amount of data. If you read it in Kindle, one of the things you'll discover is that when you're 53% of the way through, you're actually done with the book, and the rest is the footnotes. You didn't
That's a very bad way of selling the book.
No, it's really encouraging. I actually found it tremendously encouraging.
No, it's actually because 75% of the way through.
Okay.
So
what I liked... You
and it'll keep your attention. The thing about the book is that... No, fine.
You did an extraordinary amount of work in preparation for this. I'm curious what surprises you had. When you were going through this, did you have your thesis changed in any material way by the evidence as you were going along?
Yes, it changed dramatically. I mean, I only was dimly aware. I am trained both in economics and philosophy and law. And I was only dimly aware of how the actual building blocks, property, contract, bankruptcy, enforcement mechanism, so on, the things that we all take for granted as kind of the elements of our market system, how corrupted all of them had become. And what the compounding effects of all of that corruption, industry by industry, were in terms of costing so many of us so much money. Why the returns to capital as a percentage of the total economy have dramatically increased, and the returns to labor in terms of the economy have dramatically decreased. Again, I knew a lot of this, but I hadn't connected all the dots. And it was, as it became more and more and more and more visible, I became angrier and angrier. And I'm not really an angry, I'm not an angry person.
Thank goodness. I'm very close to you. But I
did become angrier because, and again, it's not at any individual person. It's not at any particular political party. My anger was was that we had allowed this system to get so fundamentally off track. And I am convinced that if more people know more about what has happened and why, we will correct it.
So one of the things that I find so troubling, and I thought the book does a great job of at least putting it in context for me, that the process that got us here began certainly in the 70s, was ripping by the 80s. And since the 80s, it's basically been an unbroken trend. And one of the challenges for any of the things you were talking about, the things you were talking about being hot air, whether it's fixing campaign finance, whether it's Glass-Steagall, whatever, is that all of the mechanisms of power are currently aligned in opposition to that, if not from a philosophical point of view, simply from an inertial point of view. And I'm curious as to whether there is a weak spot in that that you see that is the first place we could go. Like, for example, since the probability of getting a like-minded person as president exceeds the probability of getting either House of Congress right or any of the other constituencies, are there weak places that either a president can unilaterally begin to fix? Are there other places that we can together go after to begin, to begin to bring the wall down?
There is a remarkable, you start where there is broad consensus, and so much consensus that the vested interests, the moneyed interests, if you excuse the expression, actually are going to have to give in if that consensus ever actually gets together.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the most obvious that I have found around the country is busting up the big banks. I mean, the five biggest Wall Street banks in 1990 had 10% of total banking assets. By the year 2000, they had 25% of all banking assets, five biggest banks. Now, even after the meltdown, after the bailout of Wall Street, the five biggest banks now have 44% of total banking assets. In other words, we are not just riding toward another too big to fail. It is now far, far too big to fail. And that is a reality that most people don't know, but if they did, there is broad.
So what's the way to start that process? Where is the first place you go?
Well, the first place you go is you have a presidential campaign that raises the issue. Bernie Sanders has talked about it, and he's been so vocal about it and so clear about it that even Hillary Clinton is starting to move over on some of those issues.
Mm-hmm.
Not on Glass-Steagall yet, not on necessarily breaking up the banks, but on making it far more expensive for the big banks to continue to go on as they are going on before. So you begin to give legitimacy and voice to all of that, and even you get, because there's so many conservatives and Republicans, Tea Partiers, who are as upset. The Tea Party movement came out of the bailout of Wall Street. So you have a natural, very large constituency. The same thing with corporate welfare. You know, I remember in 1994, I gave a speech. Bill Clinton wanted to get rid of welfare as we knew it. That was his phrase. And I gave a speech kind of mischievously saying that maybe we should get rid of, first of all, corporate welfare and use the proceeds to enable people to get better jobs and get better kind of standards for themselves. Well, I, to this day, I don't know where I got the term corporate welfare, but I'll tell you something. One of my fellow cabinet members, whose name shall remain anonymous, he was Secretary of the Treasury, was so angry that he summoned a cabinet meeting to assail me, and everybody was yelling at me because I was sounding so radical. And they said, but the president was not there. And I said, I don't work for any one of you. You know, you want the president to put pressure on me, he's going to have to call me.
Yeah.
But I knew he never would. But right now, there is widespread consensus that corporate welfare or crony capitalism, money in politics, these are things...
Negative tax rates for the biggest companies in the economy would be a great example.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
The massive subsidies of the banks.
The subsidies, the tax breaks, all of these things. Right. People, they drive people crazy on the left and the right. Mm-hmm. And there is, I would say, in terms of pressure points, these are where you start building. Now, beyond that, if there is a major scandal, you know, you always use scandals. I mean, Watergate did beget McCain-Feingold. You always use scandals that because they focus the public's attention.
Right. Well, other than Rahm Emanuel, right, who, after famously saying never waste a good crisis, did waste the one relative to the banks.
Yes. Unfortunately, that was a waste of a crisis. And that's another discussion, but it's a good discussion.
Would you like to spend a minute, I mean, before we're going to have Q&A in just a moment, but would you like to spend a moment talking about politics and what you see in the press? I mean, you know, we see you on television, we see you hinting about your enthusiasms. Tell us a little bit about, you know, handicap the campaign for us. Tell us how we as voters can participate in bringing about a countervailing power.
Well, I don't know how many of you are active voters or active citizens. How many of you would... That's great. There's a little bit of self-selection. I think you probably might not be here unless you had some inclination in that direction. But I think that one very important principle is that citizenship means so much more than just voting. I mean, most, you know, now a lot of people don't even vote, but much more than just voting or serving on juries or paying taxes. Citizenship is about taking a very active role. Not only at your local level and at your state level. One of the problems now is we're all in our bubbles. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't, you know, to be in California, you know, you might as well be on the moon when it comes to a presidential election. Not so much a presidential primary, in the Democratic primary, but it's pretty late in the primary field. Nevertheless, most of you do have friends, I dare say, or relatives even, in places like Oklahoma, Nebraska, Arkansas, Ohio. Nobody knows anybody in Ohio? Iowa? Do you have any?
Okay, we're giving you Iowa. You go Iowa. Who's got Kansas? Who's got Kansas?
No, here's what I'm getting at. You know, I 10 years ago, I left Cambridge, Massachusetts, which is a bubble. And then I drove my Mini Cooper across America, and I moved to Berkeley. And I discovered it's the same bubble. You know, 3,000 miles, and it's the same
bubble.
Better
weather, though.
But I went across, I love driving across the United States. And 10 years ago in a Mini Cooper, there's not a single Mini Cooper in Oklahoma. And so I stopped for gas in Oklahoma City at one of those gas, and there was a gas line. So I, you know, was waiting. There were two cars ahead of me, and these truckers came up to my Mini Cooper, and they tapped on the window, and I lowered the window, and looked up, and they said, "What is this?" So this is about being in your bubble. They had never seen it. I said, "This is a Mini Cooper." And then they said, "How does anybody fit in there?" Well, I took that as an invitation. So I opened the door and I stood up and I said, "No problem." But just to emphasize the bubble aspect of all this, I said, "I'm from Massachusetts, and we're all under 5 feet tall." One of the problems we now have segregated, not only economically, we obviously segregated economically, but we've segregated geographically by our values and ideology and party politics more than ever before. And so it's very important that we reach across. I don't mean that you're ever going to convince a committed somebody on the other side, but it is very important to reach out to independents, to people who have relatively open minds, to talk and to organize. And part of what we need to do is get out of our bubbles to do that.
Beautiful. I think that's fantastic. Ted, do you want to do a little Q&A here?
Yeah, so let me just repeat the question, make sure I understand it. So what do you say to people who really fundamentally disagree with you? How do you engage them in a conversation? Because we're so out of practice engaging in conversation. And I think one way of doing it is to start with a specific, you know, that maybe something that just occurred that day, like Carl Icahn, or whatever you want to begin it, and that provides a way of getting into or illustrating a general question, money in politics, for example. Or you can start with, and I often start with facts. I mean, one of the problems is there is a lot of misinformation out there. I mean, it's just plain wrong. It's propaganda, and it's dangerous. And it's important that people have the right facts. In this book tour, I had dinner with a group of business people, business executives in St. Louis, and they were all pre-selected. I had actually asked some friends to pre-select them, and I wanted them all to think of themselves, characterize themselves as conservative Republicans. So I walked in, and there are 12 conservative Republican businessmen and one businesswoman from that area. And we proceeded to have a nice dinner, and then we got into a discussion about labor unions and their political power. And they had the wrong information. They really thought that unions were contributing much more money to politics than unions are today. And the only way I could possibly get them back on track, or get them on track, was to take my book out, wherever it is, and I had a table, and I had a citation, and some of them had iPhones, and they looked it up, and they saw that I was right. And that actually changed the tenor of the conversation quite dramatically, because you can't, you know, one of the blessings, I suppose you could say, of modern life is that people have access to information fairly readily, and truth is truth, and falsity usually, I mean, there's a lot of junk on the internet, but there are statistics that people can agree to. Is that helpful at all?
Hello? Okay. I have a few elaborate questions, but I'll make it short and sweet. I know, I got it. I'll make it short and sweet. In a nonpartisan fashion, how would you grade the Obama on the economy?
I think Obama deserves a very good grade on rescuing the country from what would otherwise be another Great Depression. I think on the bank bailout itself, I would probably give the Obama administration, just like the Bush administration, remember it was a continuation of Hank Paulson to Tim Geithner, I'd give probably a D or an F, because there were no conditions put on the banks, because there was no help to homeowners. There was supposed to be help to homeowners there. On selling a set of economic ideas to the public about what needed to be done to make the recovery stronger, beyond the stimulus, the initial stimulus, I'd probably give the Obama administration a kind of B plus or maybe a C. I think he could have done better. He was facing terrible odds, but I think that it was possible to make the arguments clearer and more simple and simpler. But let me just say one more thing about that. Nobody knew how bad the economy was in 2008 and the beginning of 2009, nobody knew how big the stimulus needed to be. Nobody. I was on a panel addressing Congress on this issue, and I was with two economists, one of whom's name is Marty Feldstein from Harvard, who's a conservative. He had been head of the Council of Economic Advisors for Reagan and several other Republicans. And there was a fellow, Mark Landy, Zandi, that between us, who was and had been the chief advisor for John McCain in the presidential election 2008. And the question Congress asked is, how big should the stimulus be? And none of us had a good answer, but they started with Marty Feldstein on the left of the panel, and Marty Feldstein said $800 billion. And I turned to Mark Zandi, who was sitting next to me, and said, where did Marty get that number? And Mark said, I have no idea. And then they asked Mark, and he said, $800 billion. And of course, they came to me, and I said, $800 billion. We were in uncharted territory, and I think in retrospect, the stimulus probably needed to be closer to, you know, 1.2 trillion. I think that, and it shouldn't have all been in the form of tax. Too much of it was in the form of tax breaks, which don't have the right multiplier effect. I don't want to get caught in the weeds here, but you get my general direction.
Okay, and now I have a working mic. here you go.
I just have two quick questions. Do you write your own Facebook posts?
Yes.
It sounded like your voice, so that makes me feel better. Also, I was a child of the 60s, okay, and it was a protest every weekend, okay, with hundreds of thousands, tens of thousands, 20,000 people against the Vietnam War, women's rights. I want to know, though, why you think young people are not driving these movements like they were in my generation. I mean, I was born in 48, so I was in my late teens, early 20s, when I protested all these various things.
Well, I think young people, number one, are very deeply involved. I mean, take for example, equal marriage rights. I don't think that would have happened had young people not been as actively involved as they have been. This generation of 18 to 25-year-olds, who I see almost every day because I teach them, and it's not just Berkeley. I was at the University of Texas last month. I was at University of Chicago about 3 weeks ago. This generation of 18 to 25-year-olds is the most, I think, idealistic and public service-minded that I've come across in my entire teaching career.
Really?
And yeah. Wow. Now, except I want to just say there are two footnotes. Number one, they are very cynical about government. And I think that cynicism about government is a self-fulfilling prophecy. Because if you're cynical about politics and government, you're cynical about our democracy. And if you give up on our democracy, you're essentially giving up on everything. And that's exactly what the moneyed interests would like. So I think that it is very important to break into that cynicism. The second problem has to do with student debt. And this generation, they are, for absolutely rational, understandable reasons, extremely nervous about the amount of debt they have and getting jobs. And it may, I think, tend to make them a little bit think twice before rocking the boat. In the 1960s, and when I was out demonstrating, we all thought, well, there's no problem. We'll always get a job. The economy is strong. We didn't have any student debt. Most of public universities were free. It was a very different time. So I think, my caveats aside, I have enormous confidence in young people.
That's great.
You do such an excellent job distilling things down to understandable terms and have such a great understanding and imparting that understanding to people writ large. If the opportunity were to present itself to you, would you ever consider being someone's running mate?
You mean... I would certainly, like anybody in this room, if somebody asks you to take part, participate in our government, you would, I think, have a duty to do so. I would have a duty to do so. I would do that. I don't think, and I don't mean to cast any aspersions, that I would willingly, happily, be a running mate for Donald Trump. But the good news is I don't think he'd ask me to. I had something else to say. Oh, I know what it was. There are different personalities when it comes to actually running for elective office. I ran for Massachusetts governor in 2002 for the Democratic nomination. There were out of a field of six. I was late getting in, didn't have much money. But I found that I was constitutionally adverse to kissing wealthy derrieres. I couldn't do it. I absolutely couldn't do it. And I'm not really an extrovert. And you have to, if you're actually running for office, you don't necessarily have to kiss wealthy derrieres, but you do have to be an extrovert. You've got to just be able to love. I mean, Bill Clinton, if he didn't get enough hands to shake in a given day, he was depressed. Al Gore was the opposite. If Al Gore had to shake too many hands in a given day, he was depressed. You don't know which side of the ledger you're on until you've actually tried to run.
I have a question over here in the back.
Hello. You mentioned that governments set the rules of the market, and you also, I think, mentioned that over the last 30 years, many of those rules and regulations have shifted in ways that have caused the wealth to be shifting upwards, and that we would be very surprised to hear about some of those details, but those details don't usually surface to the population. So I'm wondering if you can give a couple examples of those things so we can kind of have a better sense of...
Americans pay more for pharmaceuticals than the citizens of any other rich nation. Why is that? Well, the pharmaceutical companies are very powerful politically, which means they can get a rule, and I may have alluded to this already, that says that essentially it's fine for them to extend their patents protection beyond the official patent period by paying off generic drug manufacturers not to introduce generic equivalents. Now that's illegal in most other rich nations. Or to take another example, so it means we're paying more for pharmaceuticals, that means that our paychecks are being reduced, that's a pre-distribution upward. Or to give you another example, we have the most expensive internet service of any advanced rich nation, and we have the slowest internet service. Now, why is that? Well, 80% of Americans have no choice of internet service provider. Why is that? It has a lot to do with politics and political power and economic concentration. What else? Airlines.
Cell phones.
Well, we could go.
Another great example. But we have two standards. We're the only country in the world that basically forced two different standards with only two players. Therefore, they each got to be an oligopolist. They got to control the market.
And oligopolistic power means, again, we're paying more than we otherwise should. Airlines. Many people say, well, wait a minute. I'm paying as much for airline tickets as I was paying when fuel prices were three times higher. How can that possibly be? Well, it has a lot to do with the fact that 15 years ago, we had 9 major airlines, now we have 4. And when you get down to 4 major airlines, you are into oligopoly territory. That means it becomes very easy to set kind of collusively prices and rates. I could give you many, many other examples. Bankruptcy law. We have one presidential candidate who has used bankruptcy at least 4 times
to protect his assets. And yet, why is it that homeowners who are caught in a downdraft of a great recession were not able to use bankruptcy to reorganize their mortgage debt, and many of them lost their homes? Why is it that people who were former students are carrying huge student debts that are actually larger in many cases than they were when they graduated from university, and they cannot use bankruptcy to reorganize those student debts? Do you think that's just the markets? No. This is the credit card industry. It is the student debt industry. These are decisions being made politically as to how bankruptcy is going to be organized. Now, multiply what I've just said to you a thousandfold, and multiply it 365 days, actually not that, let's say 200 days a year in Washington and in state capitals. I was just talking to somebody recently about insider trading. Now, in the United States, if I am a CEO and I know that in 2 days my company is going to make an announcement that's going to dramatically affect our stock price, and I mention it to my golfing buddy, I tell him exactly what we're going to do, and my golfing buddy then goes home, says it to, tells his wife, and his wife is a member of a big sort of hedge fund firm, and she lets it be known, and a lot of her associates make big bets based on that insider information. Is that illegal? No. It is illegal in every other advanced industrial country.
Well, that used to be illegal here.
It used to be illegal here. It's no longer illegal here.
Yeah.
How did it change? How did it change?
Well, another great example, the bankruptcy law thing really matters because in entrepreneurship, most businesses are started on credit cards. And it used to be that when you went through bankruptcy, you could expunge your credit card debt. You cannot do that anymore. So it used to be that companies could give stock options to employees, which created a shared interest between employees and owners, right? Made the employees into owners. In the late 90s, those two things were just taken away, thanks as much to anybody as Warren Buffett, and simply because they were in political power and they were in a position to advantage their businesses over others. And if you sit there and you look at the difference in rules, those companies can get rid of a pension plan. They can walk away from obligations entered into that people's lives depend on.
Oh, well, the
and
airline.
Yet the very people on the other side of it can't do the same thing back.
Every major airline that has survived has gone out of its union contracts by going into bankruptcy. I mean, we could go on. We could get ourselves pretty riled up here. but you've just asked, but it's important not to get too deep into the weeds in any one of these areas. You need to know enough to know that it's going on. And what I've tried to do in the book is to categorize it in ways that people can understand and also connect all of the dots. Because the market, the so-called free market we have today, looks very different from the so-called free market we had 30 years ago. And so those pre-distributions upward are huge, and they are growing. And nobody talks about it.
We'll do two more questions. To get to some of these populist reforms that you've mentioned today and throughout your work, it seems that we need to combat the moneyed interests and the economic powers that are exerting influence on Washington with essentially people power. But referencing some of the comments that were made earlier, it seems today that the system is set up in a way where the general population doesn't have time to learn about these issues, let alone get involved with them. Whether you're a minimum wage worker working two shifts, or if you're a young professional working 60, 70, 80 hours a week on Wall Street or in elite corporate law or anything like that, the large majority of the population is working much more than 40 hours a week, 60, 70, 80 hours a week, and doesn't have time to look after their own family, let alone get involved in these issues. Is the situation today worse than it has been in the past? Is that something that you've come across in your research? And is there anything that the system can, is there anything that can be changed in the system to enable that type of civic activism?
Well, there are some studies of how Americans spend their time. And you are right. We are working harder on average and more hours than we were 20 or 30 or 40 years ago. But if you look back to the best of our knowledge at the longer term, the 1890s, the turn of the century, the 1920s, 1930s, actually, when it was an agricultural economy or when it was a factory-based economy, people were working longer hours. Agricultural-based economies are basically non-stop work, and yet you had the growth of populism, prairie populism under William Jennings Bryan. My point is that if people want to become politically active, they will become politically active. You know, so you watch a little bit less television. I don't mean to minimize the point you're making, but I think it is still possible to develop this as a priority.
Okay, we have a last question down here to the right in front.
I'm gonna put a couple of things together. One over here, put a pin on it. I saw you speak at Occupy events, the Occupy movement, the little bitty thing that happened and went away. You speak about young people and the hope that they might be able to bring change. When I look at the changes that have happened lately with the war on drugs and with gender and sexual rights, it seems that those were things that didn't cost Wall Street very much. That in fact, the place that progress is happening is the social thing, but if you follow the money, I think the feedback loops you talked about at the start of wealth changes the rules, gets more wealthy and so on, make that much harder. And I just put in Occupy because there was young people getting together on something, it amounted to little. Your thoughts?
Well, the Occupy movement was certainly an expression of populist discontent, but it was an unorganized and almost relentlessly anti-political expression. And therein was the seeds of its own demise. I remember I was invited to speak at a different Occupy gathering from the one you might have been at in Oakland, California. And I got there and they said, you can't speak. And I said, why can't I speak? And they said, well, the anarchists won't let you. I said, if they're anarchists, how can they stop me? So, I mean, you know, it was, I think Occupy did help put on the public agenda the issue of widening inequality. And that was very important. And those kinds of expressions, those upsurges of populist anger are not nothing and not for nothing. I think the nation has changed as a result. It is easier to change social than it is to change financial. But there is not that great a difference. In other words, let's take, for example, women. Women workers are most of your minimum wage workers. They're also most of the people who are facing poverty in old age because women workers just don't have as much savings. Social Security doesn't go nearly far enough for them, and they live longer. And that means that that is a social issue, but it's also a very, very practical economic issue, and it has a lot of heft behind it if people understand it as a woman's issue and also as a woman and family issue. I think, for example, to pursue that one, not only is the fight for $15 an hour, which, believe me, the Walmarts and the big fast food and restaurant association they don't want to get near, that is being won because people are mobilizing behind it. The fight not to reduce Social Security, but actually to expand Social Security is also gathering momentum. That is not going to be easy to do. It's going to require that we actually raise the cap on the amount of income subject to Social Security taxes. But As people understand that, it gets momentum. Most people didn't even know that there was a cap on the percentage of income subject to Social Security. It's now $118,500. You don't pay a dollar of Social Security above that. I mean, Bill Gates finished his Social Security payment obligations at about 3 minutes past midnight, January 1st every year. I don't want to pick on him.
Well, with that.
Wait a minute. Are we ending? Are we ending?
We're just starting.
We just started. Let me, if we are going to end, let me just, again, I want to thank all of you. Roger, I want to thank you. You were just great. Thank you. And thank all of you.